views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Come up on this edition of Perspectives, we talk about being young, Black, and in America, particularly a Black man. How is it? How do we really improve in the area of our Black men in maturity, growth, and opportunity? Have a special guest stay with us here on Perspectives. We're talking that and more.
What's on your mind? What's on your mind? What's on your mind?
Anything relevant to life, you bring it to the table. Whether you're making moves solo or a movement with a stable. No fables, just speak on your decisions. Because in the long run, it's your voice, your views, your vision. Keeping it real with many messages for you to know. This ain't radio, but DJ runs the show. Entertainment, he rocks it. Politics, he locks it. The host with the most would handle any topic. Don't forget to share your perspective with shines of light. Because it might make a difference in someone else's life.
Make a difference in someone's life. Express what's in your heart and your mind. Share your perspective.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another edition of Perspectives. I am Darren Hyman. Of course, we thank you for joining us. As always, you can watch Perspectives every week here on BronxNet's Channel 67. We also invite you to stay connected to us on our social media platforms at BronxNet TV, and then also on our website at BronxNet.org. Now, if you're looking to catch up with me personally, whether that's on our social media platforms, you can catch me on my professional page, Darren C. Hyme. That's where you can find me on Facebook. Also on Instagram and Twitter, you can catch me at DC Hyme 23. And of course, you'll be able to find some information and possibly even also some inspiration. Front and center on today's show, we're talking about being a young Black African-American male today. The challenges, how do we overcome? Also, the Olympics, George Floyd, the death of George Floyd. How did that actually impact some of the action that we saw by some of our young athletes? Well, we got a very special guest with us, and Arnold Burton is here with us to share a little bit. He's the founder of Arnold Burton LLC, and we're glad to have him here. Former NAACP president now, with Arnold Burton LLC. We're glad to have Arnold with us, and Arnold, glad to have you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. It's good to see you and good to be here again. I was an NAACP chairperson of a committee, not the president.
I should say, my bad for not really clearing that up.
That's all right. That's all right. You know, it's all good.
But you know, listen, if I gave you a promotion, listen, just, you know, listen, it's a good thing.
let me check my check.
All right. Well, all check right. This out. We want to talk for a minute. And I want to really be able to have a little conversation as we talk about where we are today, because obviously, you know, the fall is upon us. Our kids are going back to school. And I was having a conversation about the plight of young Black men in America today. And given the fact of where we are today with heightened racial tensions, with heightened, you know, COVID-19 going on, and now the Delta variant, a lot of things on the hearts and minds, particularly of young men in communities of color. And do you sense that the weight is extremely heavy?
I would say that it's more than extremely heavy. It's almost impossible. And the challenges are not only from the outside, but also from the inside, because we have to find a way to get our young men engaged in ways of looking at opportunities for themselves, not only in sports and entertainment, but in the regular world, the business world, et cetera. And obviously a lot of that has to do with education. And it also has to do with one's belief in oneself. And there we're lacking as far as I can see. If you were to skew us to where we are gender-wise, I think that our ladies, and it's a good thing, that they're improving and they're moving upward in a faster rate than our young men are. And we've got to try and see what we can do to bring our guys back up and focus in the right direction.
We talk about equality in Black America, and particularly young Black America. It's so hard to really see it. And when we look at the educational opportunities that are for whites, we know that it's disproportionate compared to that of young Black African Americans and Black males today. You know, we talk about equality in Black America, and we still got a long way to go. And people thought that because we had a Black president, we got a lot of our problems taken care of. Well, go one president more, and you got a whole lot more to talk about.
Oh boy, well, you don't even want to go there, because that, you know, that will take us on the negative path that, you know, people. I think that one of the things that I focus on, not only as an educator, but even now, even up here in Stanford, is the fact that the focus on how to get our young men going in the right direction is that they have to have a belief in themselves, all right? And that starts in the home. You know, that starts with, you know, whether or not when they come up, they are seeing the role models they need to. And if they don't have the right role model, how do they find the right role model? We would hope that in school would be one of the places where they could get that encouragement. But obviously, especially Stanford, which has a very small, I think the population of Black people up here is about 14% of the full population. And you can see how in the schools, from what I've observed, and you look at some of the scores and surveys, et cetera, the testing, our guys are at the bottom of the rung. And a lot of it is obviously with the pandemic, we've had a lot of people not in school because of the situation with sickness and death, et cetera, the horrible situation, and also just the focus of how to make it through all of that muck and mire. But the other thing is then to have the guys to think about themselves and see themselves in roles that they may not necessarily expect. When Barack Obama became the president, obviously that would help to make young Black men think that they can go anywhere in society. But the real fact of the matter is that when we look at our role models, we usually don't look that far up. We look in our neighborhoods, we look in our churches, we look at our homes, et cetera. And that's where we have to boost the attention and get the right people in the neighborhood. We need the leaders to come back and motivate our young people, motivate our men especially, to look at the possibilities that they have with regard to their lives.
Yeah. You brought up the issue of role model, and I know we don't want to talk about this guy, but I mean, I'll bring it up for this. You know, number 45 had said in a statement one time that he really feels sorry for communities of color because they don't have, African Americans don't have a lot of role models, particularly African American men don't have a lot of role models to look to. I wrote an op-ed really taking him to task for that, because I felt like, number one, that how dare you?
Right.
Number two is you have no clue. Number three, you've had opportunities on your very own TV show to put a guy forward that if it wasn't for community, you'd have never put him forward to be, you know, this apprentice champion. But the bottom line is, when we look in our communities, I'll take the premise statement that he says, we do have a whole lot of African-American role models, because yet and still, I think that many times we look at entertainers, we look at athletes, we look at these as the frontline people. But when we start looking at who we are contextually and what we do and the things that we do, I mean, obviously there's so many people that we can look at to be able to find this hope and also to be able to find inspiration.
Yes, I think the certainly the role models are there. It's to get them reactivated into being involved in the community at large. And I think that a lot of it is because of the struggle of just making it. Making the money to get your family through, et cetera. The community focus has not been the way it should be. And I talk about community activists. And one of the places where, of course, we find that a lot is in our churches, all right? The leaders that we have there. And I'm not just talking about the pastors. I'm talking about the members, the deacons, the people that know the children, the people that see the children through the week, how we get them more activated again into a role where they see themselves as not a problem, but as a solution. Because I have Mr. 45 and a lot of people, when they look at our people, they always describe our people as if we are a problem. And we're not a problem. We are just as equal as anybody else. We should be looked upon, and we should be viewed in a way that we are part of a solution. That means we need to be part of conversations that can help us to bring the solutions that we need. So we need to bring more of the community advocates again back around. But Barack Obama, that's what he was way before he was president. He was there working in the community. And I believe that that's one of the things that we need to do. We also need to get our parents to realize the importance of understanding the education system, how to manipulate the education system to benefit their children, especially as they go into high school and into college. The funding that's there for them, the scholarships, et cetera, that are available, but many times they're not being utilized the way that we would want them to be.
Yeah. And when we look at where we are, we talk about scholarships, and we're seeing more HBCUs who are actually being able to have scholarships and be able to present full scholarships. One of schools near and dear to my heart, Clinton Junior College, just announced in the 2020-21, 21-22 school year, that they'll actually be giving away free tuition to their students. And we hope to have the Clinton College president on to share with us. But when you look at the opportunities now, HBCUs really become a prime place. We're seeing athletes go there. We're seeing not just athletes, we're seeing former NFL athlete Deion Sanders go there. And we're seeing so many great things happening at our HBCUs that have taken a long time to really get.
Well, again, it's about getting it back out there to the mainstream of our people in our communities, what we really have. I know that one of the things I did when I was teaching was, you know, tell our kids about our historically Black colleges and start asking them, can you name me five historically Black colleges? And a lot of them didn't know. And so we went on this thing that we decided to investigate, go on the computers and go onto streaming and visit some of the schools and get people to be at Morehouse or at Spelman's, our young ladies, or Tuskegee, et cetera, and teach them about how these schools started, why they're so important, and what it is to feel like. I went to a historically Black college for a year, Oakwood College in Huntsville, Alabama. And it was a great feeling to be at a school where almost 100% of the student body and most of the staff were people of color. And it made you start to have a sense of who you are and actually feel better about yourself with regard to, man, there's so many people here with their doctorates and experts on this and experts on that I never even knew about. And that's one of the things. The historically Black college is a very, very important thing, and we really need to. And you're right. There are some people now, athletes now, who are advertising that more. And obviously, I guess because of what's happened over the last year, you know, there has been a need and there's been an effort to advertise those things a little bit more. But that's the way to go. That's one of the things that we definitely have to do, is get them hooked up with schools like that. And plenty of those schools have money. They have all kinds of means. They have work study and all, that you can come and get a quality education.
Yeah. Let me take a quick break and come back more and talk more with Alan Burton after we come back. Talk a little bit about that HBCU experience and what it actually means in the life of a young person. He's going to answer that question when we return right here on Perspectives. And hello, everyone. Welcome back to Perspectives. Darren Hyme here with you. Our guest, Arnold Burton, here with us as we're talking a little bit about being young, being Black, and also what it means to be that in America. Before, in our last segment, Arnold and I were sharing a little bit about what it means to have the HBCU experience. And Arnold, I want you to pick up here and share with us a little bit about this here. When we talk about the HBCU experience, you're an HBCU grad, had the opportunity to spend time there. What did that experience mean to you by way of exposure, and how did that shape your lens moving forward?
Well, I think that, you know, I was very fortunate because I, you know, had exposure from other things before I left New York City. I went to specialized high school for the arts, and, you know, I sang professionally classical music. So I had done traveling, whatever, but actually when I went down to Oakwood, I was focusing actually on another area, which was theology. And Oakwood, it was incredible. Just the fact, like I said, to be with people of your own race and just sharing, and people from different parts of the country and certain parts of the Caribbean, or everybody mixed together. But the most important thing was to actually see a lot of teachers, professors that looked just like you and that were extremely educated. Also, it boosts your self-esteem to be with people to see that were focused on education and that came down to school to get something done, and also to learn a little bit more about one's own history, learning about Oakwood, how it started there in Huntsville, Alabama, and, you know, learning about the things that went on down there. And you're in the middle of the South, that's the deep South, all right? And knowing that you are there where history happened, and slavery was, you know, that's the hub of slavery, et cetera, and how you see these big plantation buildings that were right near the college, and you could get a feel for maybe what it was that our ancestors went through. But the big thing was just to build a level of self-esteem, self-importance. I think that was the thing that stuck with me, and also the connections that I had for life because of that. The connections with people that I ended up having that I still know to this day. You know, it's incredible.
Give me a little bit about this as we talk a little bit about the experience, exposure. We talk about what's going on in a particular area, cultural sensitivity. Right now, we know that we're in the middle of some real serious racial tensions. We've got the Derek Chauvin verdict and the death of George Floyd. And much of America is now paying attention to police community relations. And they're also paying attention to activism. I want to bring the conversation, talk a little bit about our Olympic athletes. Because when we talk about our Olympic athletes right now, we see Naomi Osaka withdrawing and she's saying, listen, my mental health is important. But she also is one of those great proponents for the social justice movement and police criminal justice reform. You saw Simone Biles. And when you look at Simone Biles, you took a look at her and she's making the choice to mentally step away from some team competition, catching heat from some. But we also understood that she also suffered death in her family. So when we look at these athletes and we see them making these conscious decisions, what can we ascertain about the new reformed athlete's mind in a time such as this?
Well, I admire them and I want to give them, you know, all the props that I possibly can, because they have to have a lot of strength just to be an athlete themselves, the work, the discipline that goes on for years and years. And remember, because of the pandemic with regard to the Olympics, they had to wait another year. All right. And for some of them, they were near the end of their careers as it was age wise, and they pushed through. But if you think about what we as a people have gone through, and then our athletes who have done their best to speak up and to say things about what's going on and how they made it, how they got through. It took a lot to handle the pressure of going over to another country in the middle of COVID, and yet at the same time carrying the weight that, you know what, I have a situation where I saw a man get killed on the TV and I watched the whole thing happen, and he's one of my people, and I'm carrying this weight to represent my country, but I also have to represent my people and what we have gone through. And yes, I am happy to be an American in the sense that we deserve everything that we've worked for. We represent this country. Our people helped to build this country. So I'm not afraid to go to there and represent. I'm representing not only the country, I'm representing my people, I'm representing myself. But I admire that. But at the same time, I can imagine the pressure must have been that much more because of all the circumstances that we just alluded to, that how it could be for someone to actually have to go through what they had to go through and keep their focus and still achieve what they achieved. And with regard to Simone Biles, she doesn't have to answer to anyone because she's always already proven herself as the GOAT, you know, one of the greatest of all time in her area. But she's also a GOAT. And I look at all these young people as GOATs with regard to the courage that they had and the stamina and the fortitude that they had to go over there during a very difficult time for our people over the last year and a half, which is not over, and take their stands. And I think it's going to, in the long run, when we if we discuss it correctly and the right people focus on the right things about it, it could be a good learning tool for our young people, our younger people.
But there's an amazing amount of pressure. And I don't think anybody gets the amount of pressure that it takes to be an Olympic athlete, just to get to the place where you actually qualify for the Olympics, much less compete in the Olympics. And then if you medal in the Olympics, that's huge. And I think that we undervalue just the journey to be able to get there.
Well, I think that that's the other thing that, you know, and that's another learning tool for our young people, because anything that you want to be successful at, you have to put a lot of time and effort and focus. You have to have discipline. You have to have discipline and more discipline and more discipline. You can't hang out with your buddies and, you know, do what the normal things that you have to. You know, it's like Kobe, the great Kobe Bryant. You know, one time he was working out with the world team at the time. And, you know, they went out after a practice to hang out for a little while. And then Kobe said, I got to go. And one of the players said, you know, where are you going? He said, I've got to go and get some sleep because I've got to get up and work out. And the young man said to Kobe Bryant, but you're Kobe Bryant. And Kobe Bryant said, but that's why I'm Kobe Bryant. because he understood what it took to do what he needed to stay at that level. And that elite level, which each one of us can aspire to in whatever our field of talent is, that elite level comes from that discipline, that self-belief, and that exposure to people who are like what we want to be, to see what they do and to model after them. So I think that what these young people, you can't even imagine the things that they have gone through just to separate themselves from all the negativity that could be around them, which could keep them off of their focus.
Yeah. Arnold Burton, our guest here with us on Perspectives. We want to take a quick break and come back with more with Arnold for our final segment. But Arnold, I'll tell you a quick thing about that. When we talked about Kobe Bryant talking about the world champion, that same story was told with Allen Iverson. And Allen Iverson was him and Allen were hanging out there in Philadelphia, and not hanging out, but they were supposed to hang out. And Allen asked him to hang out with him. Kobe said, "No, I'm right. going to work out." Allen said, "I'm going to the club." Yep. We knew what happened with Allen.
There you go.
We saw what happened with Kobe.
Lord is my shepherd.
Yeah. Yes, sir. So, listen, let me take a quick break. Come back with more with Arnold. In this last segment, we're going to talk about how do we empower our young people. We'll talk about that right after this. Back here on Perspectives, Darren Hyme here with you. Our guest in studio, Arnold Burton, who is the founder of Arnold Burton LLC, one who has had his foot to the fire working with young people and really being a voice and an activist within our community for years. And it's a pleasure to have him sharing with us and bringing us a perspective here on our show. Talk a little bit in the last segment about what it means to be an Olympic athlete. Well, I want to ask Arnold the question now when it comes to really empowerment, because we know that once a male, a female, those of us who are in our community understand a little empowerment goes a long way. You can take somebody with a bad trajectory, and yours truly is a perfect case of example. You know, I was thrown out of high school, but I am where I am today because I received empowerment in my life. So talk to me a little bit about how do we get to the place of better empowering people. And what we can do, what are some simple ways that we can empower? Because we think that sometimes it requires a whole lot of money, but there's some other things that we can do to really empower our young people today.
Well, first of all, it doesn't always start with money. Your health is your wealth, right? First of all, you want to keep yourself in good health. That means taking care of your body and having a mental health. And that's why these young athletes, when they started talking about mental health, that was very important to them. You know, can you imagine what the slaves had to go through to survive what they survived for us to be where we are today? I mean, we need to think about the tenacity that they had to have when their families were broken up and people were killed and they were maimed, et cetera. And then they kept pushing on, as we even saw in the biographical story of Roots and the family journey. We saw how they kept stay there, the willpower that they had. And that's one of the things you start by believing in yourself and finding people who will help you move on your journey. The thing that one needs to think about is making sure that the journey is a positive journey, right? So making sure that you're around positive people that are not gonna lead you in dangerous paths. And the other thing is then to make a plan. And to make a plan, you don't need money to make a plan. All you need is a pen and a pencil or a computer or whatever you use to write down what you would want to be. And you know, and especially when you're young, you may not know exactly what you want to be. But as you start to get into middle school and high school, you'll start to see maybe that you have talents that you never discovered, and perhaps a teacher or a mentor can help you move a little further. But the bottom line is to be empowered, you also must begin to expose yourself to different things. And I will tell you, you know, I was a classical musician. I still am, but I mean, I performed as a classical musician. And, you know, one of the things I did when I was in high school, a lot of the things I couldn't afford. So I just went to the library and I started to listen on tapes to different musicians performing. And because I was a singer, I sang in different languages. I learned how to speak German just from listening to records at the Lincoln Center Library in New York. It was finding a way when people tell you that there is no way. And I think that's a very important thing. finding a way when people tell you there is no way, because there always is a way. You just have to make sure it's a good way, something that will not harm you or harm our society. If you do that, you'll start to move on that track. And as you move up the track, you'll start to be able to find out that you will begin weeding out the people that may be in your way. And that are those are the people that are the naysayers saying that you can't do it. All right. You will find out what you can do and what you can't do. But you must give yourself the opportunity and the belief that you can move forward. So you have to have exposure, and you have to have belief to go and get that exposure. And as you do that, you'll be surprised the doors that may open to you. And be ready. So that don't say, well, I'm going to be a track star, and you never put on any sneakers and never ran around the track field or never ran in your house. And yet all those months you went by and you said, I'm going to be. No, you have to start being where you are right. Where you are right in your neighborhood. You have to start with your belief and make it happen. If you're in your apartment and your apartment has a little area for you to walk back and forth, then start walking back and forth there. Start lifting up little weights in your room if that's how you're going to build up. But even not just from an athletic standpoint, but from a psychological standpoint, from an academic standpoint, you could do that with school. You could do that in every way. And also a spiritual. Have some kind of spiritual tenacity about you. Believe that there's a man upstairs, whoever you want to believe. I don't know what you're going to call him. I call him God. All right. That's up there that can help you and take you on the journey that will get you and on higher ground. I wish I had more time, because I would go on and on and on, because we do need to break it down. And I would encourage you, young persons that are out there, and older people, because it's never too late to always believe that you can do something positive, no matter where you are, and find the people who are going to be positive like you. As you do that, you'll be surprised what happened. I can hang around Darren, and I know I'll be a rich man one day.
I can hang around you, and I can become even richer. How about that? So, and I'm getting, and we're getting rich knowledge here today too. But yeah. I think you said something very important. It's not it's important for us not to get ready, but to be ready. Right. Because I think we miss a lot of opportunities, and we miss the opportunities to really make something that. Of ourselves, or to have a door that's open, yes, that potentially could take us to a life-changing, career-altering move. But so many people talk about what we could do, yes, or what we should do, and you can't. You have to be ready, and can't be getting ready. Because if you're getting ready, you're going to miss the bus. And I think a lot of people miss the bus by getting ready.
Do I have 15 seconds to say this?
Yeah.
Les Brown, the motivational speaker, he always talks about the fact that someone told him that, you know, or he may have said that you have your dreams with you wherever you go. And the worst thing would be if it could happen that when you are near your death, that your dreams could talk to you and say, we're dying with you because you never did anything with us. And I always have thought about that. When you have a dream, when you have a vision about doing something, try it out. You know, give it a try. Push forward. Just don't lay it aside and say, well, you know, I could have done that, blah, blah, blah. Coulda is a dangerous word, all right? Keep that out of your vocabulary. Try and find things and try it out. You may be surprised what happens when you do that. And it may be, you may not become an athlete, but you may become a very good sports reporter, or you may become a sports trainer. That's something around athleticism. So whatever it is, try it out. Don't just say, well, you know, I don't know, because that will die with you, and that's not a good thing.
Arnold Burton, I wish we had more time, but this is all the time we got. And we made the most of it today, brother. Thank you so much for being with us.
Pleasure. Pleasure. Always a pleasure.
All right. Arnold Burton, the founder of Arnold Burton LLC, our guest here on Perspectives. We want to thank him for sharing some real powerful tips on empowerment and really grabbing the bull by the horns. That's important, that many people need to understand. If we're going to make it, we have to learn how to grab the bull by the horns. All right. I'm Darren Jaime. Thank you for watching Perspectives. Be sure to check us out next week. Another episode coming your way. Until then, stay safe. God bless. It's been a pleasure coming to you. Share your perspective with somebody else. It just might make a difference in someone else's life. Take care.